I don't know how come they asked me to come there and make you some speech, man. I didn't used to done that, you know, and I didn't got too much education that to begin with, man. I can't read and write at all. Well, in fact, I just go to school one day for my brother, man, just to eat his lunch, you know. Anyhow, man, I'm travel salesman, you know. I work up and down the Gulf Coast, all in the south there, and it's a lot of interesting thing happen here, there, and yonder, you know. Like the other day, man, I was to Lake Charles over there. I'm going to visit with some of my kinfolk there. I don't know how you call that in English, but by law, that fella can sleep with my sister, you know. So he was telling me one day, he was standing in front of the post office to Lake Charles there, and he feels somebody tap him on the shoulder, and he turned around and look, and he's a good friend, you know. He said, look, Cyprian, he said, you was in big hurry? Cyprian said, well, no, not too much. He said, what you got on your mind there? Well, look, he said, I want to go in the post office right there and put my apply for the mail route job. I see the advertise on the paper for that, you know. But he said, though, I don't know if I'm can answer all them questions or not. And he said, that fella liable to got me in some bond there. And he said, maybe you can come with me. And I got in some trouble, you can get me straight out, huh? So Cyprian said, well, I don't know. He said, I can't stand outside the door there. And he said, if you get some question what you don't know, come ask me, you know. Mom, I said, I'd appreciate that. So he go in there, you know, and after a while he come out mad like everything. He said, well, what's the matter there? You clear? He said, didn't got the job? Poor my Cyprian, he said, let me tell you something what happened in there. He said, tell that fella I won't put my plow for the mail route job, you know. So that fella give me some paper then, tell me fill out all them question there, man, fill in the blank space like that, you know. So he said, I'm done pretty good, until I get to the bottom of that front page there. When I get down there, they got a question like that, say, how far it is from here to the moon? Man, I just give that fella them paper back. I say, well, the devil with that, man, that's the route I'm gonna have. I don't want the job. So one time there, I'm to New Iberia, you know, and that Bayou Tesh run along there, you know, and it's a little ways out from town there. Right along the bayou, they got old run-down house, man, poor tenant farmer lived there. Man, didn't got all them up-to-date facility like what we got in town, you know. Got them light, you push the button and the light come on, and them little stove, you know, turn the switch and the fire jump on the burner, you know, stuff like that. Anyhow, right along the bayou there, he got one of them two-hole job was sitting there, you know. And man's period of time and the rain, the wash water, just about get the foundation. So one day, Sostan, he's about for 10-year-old, man. He's playing around out there. He noticed that, how that old toilet lean, you know. So man, he go there and he just push that thing in the bayou. So after a while, his papa see him in the yard, man. He say, Sostan, man, if you why sit, son? He say, son, that's you playing around that old toilet there a while ago, man. Push that in the bayou. Ah, oh, man, where, Papa? It's like George Washington talk about. He said, don't never supposed to tell a lie about nothing. It's every time told the truth, you know. He said, I got to tell you, Papa, man, I'm the one do that, me. He said, well, son, come on, go in the house with me. Boy, I'm going to tan you good for that. Oh, man, no, hold on, Papa. He said, Jim, man, you don't remember that story about George Washington there? Say, when he go get his little axe and he chop that cherry tree down, well, he tell his papa he's the one do that. Well, his papa don't tan him, huh? Well, man, no, son. But he say his papa wasn't sitting in that tree when he caught it down, either. The other night, man, I'm standing downtown there on the corner waiting for the bus to come by, you know, right on front of the drugstore there. And pretty soon, man, I see a car, he come real fast, and when he get right on front of that drugstore, man, he break his car quick, man, he jump out, run in the drugstore, you know. Well, I can't imagine what's going on there, me, so I just slip to the door there, I want to find out, you know. So that fella run up to the counter and he say, Hey, bear, he say, Mac, quick, what you got good for the hiccup there? But that bat didn't pay him no mind. He was behind the counter with his mop. He was mopping the floor, you know. Clofar said, hey, bear, man. He said, quick, I ask you what you got good for the hiccup there. Well, hey, bear, he was working his way from behind the counter with that wet mop, you know. Man, he said, take a bead on Clofar's face, and he take that mop in both hands, and he swing from the floor. Man, he catch a bear right in the face, man, caught him a flip, you know. Man, he jump up, he said, doggone, no. He said, for how come you throw me that wet mop right in my face? He said, I just ask you what you got good for the hiccup, eh? Man, he said, God don't say, you don't got the hiccup now, eh? He said, by joke, it's not me got the hiccup, it's the old lady out there in the car what got that. There was got a fella stayed to Opelousas over there, you know. And he never did take no airplane ride trip there. So he decided he save his money, he gonna make a trip there. So he come in Lafayette, get on them Easter airline, you know. And he say he noticed that when he get there, he said, well, see, big red truck was putting some gasoline to that airplane, you know. So man, he said, they take off, make like a bird, come to New Orleans there. And he said, they come down on the ground, and when they light there, well, they stop. Well, here come that red truck, he pass and put some more gasoline, you know. So he said, man, after a while they take off, they come to St. Louis over there. And man, he said, come on the ground. He said, by joke, there's that red truck, drive there and put some more gasoline there. So man, he said, by and by, when they finally get to New York there, he said, that pilot, man, he kind of circled the field, you know, kind of banked that plane. He look out the window there, man, he can see that red truck sitting down there, you know. So when everybody start unclimb that airplane, you know, that pilot, man, he come out, he look at his wristwatch. He said, man, we make good time. You average 250 miles an hour. Man, Richard said, what you talk about? You make good time. He said, the next time I'm going to rode in that red truck. He was waiting there when he get there. I was used to have first cousin with me that she work out of Lafayette with them welfare compartment, you know. So she make them run in the field every day, you know, and past this is maybe somebody sick, need medicine, you know, and attention some kind. So one day she's way back there in the country and she's coming in and she see old two-story house all run down and she thought to herself, well, she never did stop there, you know. So she's gone see that. Maybe it's got somebody, maybe needs some help. So she go walking up to the porch there. They got a little boy about 10-year-old. He's playing around the front porch. And she says, son, say, you mama's to the house there? Oh, man, no. He said, that's about a year ago that mama's gone crazy. Man, they got to take him to that asylum, however you call that crazy house, to Pineville, you know? Man, she said, I'm sorry to hear about that. But you papa, man, he's there, huh? Man, no, he said, that's about 6 months after they take mama to Pineville. Papa, him too, he's gone crazy. My dad got to take it to Pineville with mama there. Man, gee, son, she said, you don't have more than you share of tough luck, huh? But you're not there by yourself, huh? Oh, man, he said, no, my brother Tofield, man, he's in the house there. Oh, well, she said, that's good then. She said, if you don't mind, how about call your brother there? Well, he said, that ain't going to do no good to call Tofil, no, man. He said, he's tied up in the house there. She says, tied up, or how come? Well, man, he said, Tofil, he think he's a chicken, him. She said, well, son, if your brother think he's a chicken, you don't believe you ought to send him to Pineville with your mama and papa there? Well, no, he said, we can't send Tofil over there, man. We got to have them eggs. The other night I was to Crowley over there visit with some friend what I got, Fontenot, you know. Man, he's big sport, him. All the time like to hunt, man, fish, stuff like that. When you pass to his house, that to his den, he got some stuff, duck, you know, man. He got some stuff, fish. He got some deer head on the wall there. Got some bear rug on the floor, man. Everything what you can talk about. So one day, when I go there, I look on the floor, got big moose head stuck on the wall there, you know. I say, Fontenot, that moose head, I said, the last time I'm here, I didn't saw that. I said, why you take that? Oh, he says, got me and two friends, we going to Montana, that make some moose hunt, you know. And he said, man, when we get to that hot shack, he said, the next morning we get up early, then he said, I take my rifle, man. He said, I start walk down the trail. And he said, I didn't go too far. And I look around, my dad's that big bull moose look right on my face, you know. Man, that thing throw me some scare, man. He said, I start run back for the shack, you know. Man, he said, that bull moose is so close on me, he said, I'm scared to open the door to got in. Afraid he gone got in there too, you know. So man, he said, I just start run a circle around that haunt shack there. And he said, we go round and round. And he said, after a while, I look on the side of my face there in the wind, I see a bottle. I said to myself, well, that's turpentine, you know. So the next time I pass them, I grab them bottle fast like that, man, I keep on running. And after a while, I begin to gain on that bull moose, you know. Man, about three more round, man, it's me chase the moose then, you know. So man, when I get close there, I pull that stop of that bottle, put that right on top of his back, his tail, you know. And pretty soon, man, that bull moose, he stop and he start shake all over, you know. Man, he start shake and shake, you know. So he said, they got a big oak tree right there. That bull moose, he back up to that big oak tree, man, he start rub on that tree, back and forth, rub and rub like that, you know. He said, well, when that bull moose stop rubbing on that tree, he said, that's all what he got left right there. Now, I was talking with Philibert the other day. He's a little boy there. His papa died about 2 years ago, but man, that his papa used to be good with Philibert, you know, take him hunt and fish, stuff like that there. So I was talking with Philibert after his mama married again, you know. Man, I said, Philibert, your stepdaddy, may I treat you, for a good? Well, man, yeah, he says, fair, is not like my real papa there, you know. But he said, when I come home from school, now once in a while, he take me, we go in the boat, go way out there in the lake, you know, but for 2 miles. And every time he take me out there, he was let me swim back, you know. I said, well, Philibert, say, take you 2 miles in the lake, man, let you swim back like that? He said, yeah, but every other day I do that. Man, I said, Philibert, that's a long ways to swim. I said, that's kind of hard to do for a little boy your age, huh? Oh, he says, it's not too bad when I finally get out that sack, you know. The other day, I'm talking with Felix, he tell me he was been to Baton Rouge there, you know, to the state capital, and he said, stay there all day long, and he was coming back late that night there, and he said, get between Port Barry and Opelousas there, and he said, see some light coming right at him, man, he's that light way up on top the highway, you know. So man, he say, pull over there, he say, can't imagine what is that, you know, and got red light all around on that, almost take the ditch, you know. So when that contraption get there and stop, Felix, he see that's one of them automobile transports, you know. So that fella stop, he say, you got some trouble? He say, geez, my friend, he say, when I see you was come there with them light shining high like that, all them red light, I just thought to myself, well, if that thing is wide as it is high, no, I can't pass there, you know. The other day I'm talking with R. Snow, and he was telling me, you know, I was getting ready when my daughter finished college, school last year, I was going to send him to college. So we was talking about this college, that college, you know. So I asked him about LSNU there. Well, my friend, he said, let me tell you one thing. He said, I'll try to send my daughter to LSNU, and she's there so about for 3 weeks. And we get long letter one day, and my daughter tell me, she said, man, guess what? My daughter tell me everybody at that LSNU all use the same curriculum, you know. Well, miss, I didn't thought too much about that, but the next letter we get with my daughter there, she tell me one day she catch one of them fella peeping at her thesis, you know. So right there I decide, well, I believe I'm going to take my daughter out that college. Well, I say, well, I'm giving him one more chance. So the next letter we get with my daughter there, she tell me the boys and girls all matriculate together there. So I tell him, well, that's a call of heart right there, because anyhow, when we was young once, we used to do that, you know, man. I don't want all that going on today. I know everybody can remember what happened there almost for 3 years ago, last June, you know. And June this year is going to be for 3 years when them Hurricane Audrey hit in South Louisiana there. Man, you know something, them tidal wave come there, that water come 16, 18 feet high, man, killed plenty of people, maybe better than 500, but killed a lot of animals, you know, every kind of animal what get around there. So when that high water is finally gone back to the Gulf there, it leave a lot of filth, man, stench and debris, stuff like that. So the Red Cross think the best thing to do, man, put some little hut around in the lower part, man, Cameron, Calcook, Shoe Parish, then man, give some typhoid shot. And they ask everybody, come take that typhoid shot, man, to protect yourself, you know. So I was going in Kaplan one day and I stopped by them little hut what they got there and got great big French woman come walk in there and the nurse sitting behind the table, you know. And she said, nurse, well, that's the place right there where we supposed to pass to take them shot for that typhoid what they gonna give. That nurse, she said, well, yeah, that's one place, all right. But she said, that depend on where you live, you know, and your name. Oh, well, she said, me, I'm Madame Melançon, and I stay way over there on Pecan Island, me. Oh, well, Madame Melançon, she said, you're going to have to take that shot in your precinct. She said, in my precinct? And she said, how come I got to take that in my precinct? I see the mother lady get that in the arm there. I was talking with a good buddy what I got, he stayed to Baton Rouge, and he tell me he was got in the army, you know, man, he said they sent him way back over there in Texas, you know. And he said he never see the sand pile high like that, and they got to march every day, you know. And he said that then about every other day, man, they got to pass on the rifle range that to practice shot at them target, you know. Man, he said they lay down, man, they sit down, they stand up, they kneel down, every way what you can talk about, they practice shot at them target there. So he said one day he was there when he get all through with his practice shot, man, he put his rifle down, passed down the line to see how his body make out, you know. So by and by he get back, well, his rifle is gone, he can't find it, you know. So when he get back to the camp, he go to the big warehouse there, and he tell that fella, he say, look, my friend, he say, I got to have another rifle in me. That fella say, man, what you talk about another rifle? He say, man, what happened with the first one we give you? Ha, man, he say, it's gonna pop. He say, look to me like somebody steal that, man, I lose it, something, man. Well, son, man, he say, if you don't lose that rifle, you got to pay that before we can give you another one, you know. Man, he said, what you talk about? I got to pay that. Well, sure, anything what you gonna lose like that, he said, you got to pay that, you know. Gee, man, he said, suppose that's a Jeep what I lost there. he said, man, it's the same difference. Jeep, machine gun, tank, rifle, anything what you lost, man, you got to pay that, you know. So he started a little bit. He said, Dad, gum, no. He said, nah, no, how come them captain go down with his ship? But he was moved, you know, he was moved to Baton Rouge from the country there, you know. His papa used to work to one of them pumping plants way out there, and he get promotion, he moved in town there, you know, and in the city there where they got camp, you know, got all them house furnished. And they didn't use the house all fixed up like that. So one day that boy, he's right back, Joseph, he's right back to his friend. He said, man, my friend, he said, I wish you can pass and see that house what we move in there. He said, they got one big room on the front, man, just to sit around in. Don't just sit there and talk, you know. And he said, they got the room next with that, got big table and chair, man, just to sit down, man, eat your food, you know. And then the next room on that, man, just got stove, all that stuff, man, to prepare that food there, you know. And on the other side of the house, he said, got two great big room, man, got bed and closet stuff for put your clothes, you know, and bed for sleep, stuff like that. But he said, in the middle of them two bedroom, man, he said, they got another little room there. But he said, all that stuff what they got that, man, he said, we can't figure that out, you know. Say, we got big tub, we figures for take baths, you know, and got another little basin there, figure that's for wash your face and hand. But he said they got another thing there, got two lid on that, and Papa used that to wash his feet in, but he said them lid keep fall on his shin, you know. So Manny said, take them lead off. Well, he gave Mama the top lead for breadboard, and we used that other picture to frame Grandpa's picture with that. That. You know, to rain Louisiana there last year, Benoit was having some trouble there, was trying to organize them little town team, you know. Every year they all play together around here in the vicinity there. Benoit tried to get 9 men with some experience, you know. And man, he worked hard at that, because Benoit faithful like everything there. So man, the season is just about ready there, and Benoit still got my just 8 men, you know. Well, when the first game is ready, he got to take a greenhorn there, you know. A rookie may put that in his lineup. Man, he put that rookie in center field way back there, you know. Well, he say, look like everything going along for the good, but man, he says, not long they start knock them high flop ball man center field, you know. And that rookie run around out there, and he let 3 of them drop right on the ground there. Man, Benoit get his mad up, he go out there, tell that rookie, say, look, boy, say, go sit on the bench. Man, say, can't caught nothing anyhow, you know. So Benoit stayed there, and after a while, man, them high fly balls start come again, man. Benoit, he missed 3 in a row, too. After a while, he come in, he said, God bless, no. He said, that rookie got that center field so messed up, man. He said, nobody can play out there, no. You know, I went straight to Vail Platte there, and he tell me all the time he was reading the newspaper, man, hear about them big stock market, what they got to Fort Worth, you know. So he decide he's going to take some cattle, go and see what it's all about, you know. So by and by, when he get to Fort Worth with that big load of cattle there, you know, he's kind of hungry. So he stop his truck there, man, he go walk in, put a nice cafe there, you know. He walk in there and look around, man, it's big, poorly place. He start to going out, but he say, man, he's hungry, going to eat something, you know. So man, he sit down to the table, then got a girl come bring some little tablet down. He look at that and he say, honey, he say, man, I didn't want no magazine, besides, I didn't got no picture on that. He say, I want just something to eat, you know. But she say, man, that's menu. He say, well, man, I don't want that. I want me a little steak there. Oh. She say, you want steak? How you want that cooked? Me say, I want that cooked good, me. She said, man, you want the big one or the little one, the medium? Why, how you want, man, just the small one? I said, I'm not too hungry, but he said, I like good steak. He said, just brought me a small steak there. So that girl's gone away, and after a while she come back, man, she got great big platter, great big thing, that steak hang all on the outside, man, you know. Man, I'd want to look at that, and he said, well, hold on, honey. He said, man, I didn't ask you no big steak, man. I just asked you a little steak, man. He said, I can't eat that. Well, she said, that's little steak there in Texas, you know, everything big. She said, that's the smallest what we got. God bless, man. He said, you mean to tell me that's the smallest steak what you got? Man, yeah, that's the small one. She, man, said, show it to look at the big one then. But he said, I tell you what, I'm just going to eat what I want, because I can't eat all that, man. What, she say, something to drink? I say, yeah, just brought me a glass of milk there. So after a while, she come back, got a great big high mug, you know. He said, hold on, honey. He said, man, didn't understand, man, I just want glass of milk. What, she said, that's ordinary glass of milk down in Texas, you know, everything big there. He said, that's the smallest what you got? Man, she said, for sure, that's the smallest, that's just ordinary glass of milk. God bless. Well, he said, I'm just going to eat what I want then, you know. So when he get all through, he go pay the cashier, and he asked the cashier, he said, by the way, he said, where's the man's restroom? So the fella tell him, say, you got to go through that door there and go in the bar, and he's down at the end of the bar there, you know. So he walk in that door there, and he look at the bar, he run the length of the block there, big, long bar, you know. And he look at that, he say, bartender. He said, that's just one bar what you got there? Well, yeah, he said, that's just one bar. For how come? Man, he said, I never did see big long bar like that. Well, he said, in Texas, everything big, you know. Oh, he said, by the way, he says, I'm looking for the restroom. Oh, he says, way down at the end of the bar there, the last door on the left, you know. So I say, he starts stroll down there, man. He look at all the mirror, them picture, and all the decoration, what they got, you know. And by and by, man, he say, finally get to the end there, but he don't forget which door to go, so he opened the door on the right, you know. He just opened the door, man, step in there, and he fall in a big swimming pool there, you know. Man, he start trash around and hit that water. He said, don't flush it, don't flush it, man. You know, my friend Trahan, that he's working with one of them big oil field trucking contractor, you know, and he haul all that heavy oil field machinery up and down the highway to them oil field, you know. And so he kind of get to suspicion one day, his wife playing around a little bit, you know, but you don't know that for sure, you know. But anyhow, when he get back in town one day, he's gone to them little camera shop there, and he buy a little camera, man. He take that back to his house, you know. And so he rigged that up behind the curtain down in his front room, and he passed a string around, passed that, and tied that under the couch, you know. He kind of, man, fixed booby trap there, you know. So, man, he said he's leave, and when he come back, he get them little camera down, he go to them photograph shop, because he see them cigarette butt, man. He know his wife don't smoke, you know. So he tell that man to the camera shop, man, he said, quick, my friend, he said, I want you to envelop them film there. So when that fella get them film enveloped, he look at that, just little bitty thing, you know, and he look, it look like two people sit on the couch, you know. He say, hold on, my friend, he say, look, he say, I can't tell too much from that little bitty film what you got there, man. He say, can't put some more bigger than that. He say, I want to find out who is them two people there. Well, he say, I can blow that up, maybe I can put you some postcard size, you know. Man, he say, put me some postcard size. So when that fella finally get them blow up, man, postcard size, he look, and sure enough, man, he recognize his wife good, you know, but he still can't figure out who is that man. He said, my friend, he said, look, he said, I just want to find out who is that man. I know that's my wife, but I want to find out who that man is. He said, if you're going to make one more bigger than that, that don't going to brought that out good? Well, man, yeah, he said, I can put you one about 16 by 16, that going to brought the whole thing out, you know. Man, he said, put me just one like that, you know. So man, when he finally get that blow up, he look at that and he say, bad joke, he said, that's Augustine, my good friend with me too. But he didn't say nothing, he's gone to the pusher there. He said, look, my friend, he said, the next trip what I make, he said, I want to talk with Augustine, how about let him come swamp on my truck, huh? So man, he said, they get a far piece from town, you know. So he got a little box down there, he reach in that box and get him little bitty film what he got, you know. And he said, Augustine, man, he said, look at that, he said, who you believe that is, huh? Augustine, he looked that little film, met twist that around, look, you know. But joke Trahan, he said, look to me like man and woman sit on the couch, but he said, I can't tell who is that, me. He said, wait, Augustine. So he reached, get them one postcard size, you know. He said, Augustine, he said, look at that one postcard size. He said, you know who is that, huh? He look at that, he said, well, yeah, Trahan, he said, man, that's your wife sit on the couch with somebody, but he said, I don't know who is that man, me. Well, he said, hold on, Augustine. So man, get that one 16 by 16. He said, look at that, Augustine, man. He said, I bet you know who is that man, huh? Oh, man, for sure. He said, Trahan, well, that's me. He said, you dad gone betcha that's you, Augustine. He said, now I'd like to know just what the devil you gone done about that there. Trahan, he said, let me tell you something, man. He said, now don't lose your temper, but he said, I'm just poor man, me. He said, just work once in a while, swamp on them truck, you know, man, got wife and big family that to support. He said, I don't make too much money. But Trahan, he said, I told you what I'm going done with you. He said, I'm going to take six of that postcard size there. There was a fellow one day was telling me, you know, he said, was gone to them army recruiting place, man. They was putting him, he won't got in the Air Corps. So man, I said, they get him to the Air Corps, you know. But he said, by joke, he stayed there a little while, and after a while, man, they transfer him and put him in the parachute division, jump out them airplane, you know. I said, didn't like that too much. He said, but every day, he said, they march and march, you know, to get tough for them jump off them airplane, you know. And he said, after they get too much like that, he said, that fella, the captain make everybody come sit down, and he start lecture, you know. Now he say, my friend, he say, I want you to listen well. He say, I want to explain you that. He say, when we gonna got up there, he say, you're gonna have two parachutes. You're gonna have one little one on the front, what open automatic. Man, when you jump, you don't got to worry about nothing, man. That little one open by himself, you know. But he said, just in case that little one don't open, he say, you got that string, that rip cord, man. He say, you pull that. He said, that big one gonna hope for sure, man, let you come slow to the ground, you know. But my friend, he said, when you gone got to the ground, he said, stay right there, don't go away. Because it's got a man in a jeep going to pass that to pick you, to took you back to the base, you know. Well, he says, every day, man, we march and march. Then we go sit down, listen to the captain. And he keep talking about them two parachutes. One open automatic, my just in case. He said, my pull them strength. That big one going to open. Then look like he kind of get his mouth up and he said, God bless my friend. He said, when you get on the ground, he says, stay right where you is, man, because that fella in that jeep going to be look for you, you know. Well, by and by, man's come the day, you know. A man put a bunch in them big airplane, man, we gone way upstairs there. He said, I don't know, man, we get about 4,000 feet, something like that, you know. Man, everybody start unload. Man, he said, I'm coming down in the parachute, man. He said, I keep wait and wait for that little one to open automatic, you know. But he don't rope. Well, I thought to myself, that fella must have just lied about that, you know. So when I wait so long, he don't rope, man. I reach them and I get them string, that ripcord, man. He said, pull that, and he come loose right in my hand. That big one don't rope. I said, now, what you thought about that? That fella lied to me about that stuff. He said, I bet you $4 when I get on the ground, that fella in that jeep ain't gonna be there either. And you know, I was get to feeling bad there some time ago, you know. And my wife keep telling me, she said, honey, she said, I better pass to the doctor's office. Well, man, I don't like to go there, you know. But so one day she insists, she said, I'm going with you. I'm going, so you're going to go to the doctor's office. So we get there and she said, doc, she said, I want you to give my husband a checkup. Say, I believe you got something wrong. So the doctor, he kind of look at me and he shake his head. He said, lady, he said, man, I sure don't like the looks of your husband. Well, doc, she said, to be honest, man, I don't either, but he's good to the kids there. You know, there's three Frenchmen was in that World War II there, and they was stationed overseas, you know, and man, they got all them shell break every place, all that cannon going on. And them fellas get effect, man, can't hear good no more. It's almost deaf, you know. So they was to the hospital and they was, how they call, recuperate, something like that. He was getting well anyhow, but they can walk around a little bit, but man can't hear too good, you know. So one day they decide to go and play golf, and that was in England there, man. So they get way out down the golf course, and one of them Frenchmen, he kind of look around, you know. And he said, this Wembley? The next one, he said, no, it's Thursday. The third one, he said, well, me too, man. Let's go get a red pop. That's down there at Morgan City one time. It's got two Frenchmen, they was getting some trouble, you know, they was kill a fellow over there. So man, they get the mob, the posse and all that stuff, they start hunt for Pierre Antinome, you know. And by and by they catch up with him way back there along the bayou, and they got them great big oak tree there. So they got the rope and everything. Man, they didn't go and brought that to town, you know, to the law there. He decided he's gonna string him right there, you know. So they throw them rope high over the lamb there, hang out over the bayou like that, you know. So they get old Pierre, man, they tie his neck good on that rope, man, and they swing him out there. Well, the rope, he come loose from his neck, and he fall in the water. Man, he swim fast to the other side. Man, a fish can't swim more fast than Pierre when he take off, you know. So, man, Tinom look at that, and he look at that rope. He said, hold on, my friend. He said, now, when you going to put me there, man, he said, tie that rope good, yeah, because I can't swim, man. The other night, my wife tell me, you know, it was keeping my little grandson. He's almost for 2 year old there. A little better than 2 year old. Anyhow, he wake up, she says, about 2 o'clock in the morning, start cry. And she go see about it, you know, man. He say, want some drink of water there. Well, she get him a drink of water, man. And after he get kind of pacified and quiet down, he say, Granny said, you gonna tell me a story, huh? And she says, son, she said, look, she says, 2 o'clock right now, she says, your grandpa's gonna be here pretty quick. He can tell both of us a story there. You know, the other day I was going to Church Point over there, and you know, man, they got a lot of oil land around there, and So this old Richard got a lease over that big farm, you know. And everybody tried to lease that big acreage what he got, you know, but he kind of greedy like, and he keep hold out for more money and more money and more money, you know. He said, don't go and let that go like that. So it's got another oil company move right next with his property there, man. They drill some oil well, man. He's dry. Didn't make nothing, you know. So when I was going through there, well, I was going down the highway, you know, when I didn't heard about that, you know. So right along on side the road there, I see this fella sitting in the ditch, you know, around on the edge of the ditch. Then he's sitting there, got look like he got a steering wheel in his hand. He goes, rrr, rrr, man. He blows on, honk, honk. And he came, I stopped my car, man. I get out and I look at that. I walk all around. I say, hey, my friend. I say, what's going on there? He said, well, I'm driving my Cadillac there. I say, you drive your Cadillac? I look and they got a fella sitting in the tree. I said, my friend, I said, what the world you was doing up in the tree there? Jeez, he said, you don't think I'm going to get on there and let that fella run over me, huh? To Lake Charles the other day, I was talking to them army recruit officer, you know, and he was telling me was got a fella come right there, and he said, look, he said, fella, you was take somebody for the Navy? He said, no, he said, that's for the Army. He said, we just recruit. He said, how come you want got in the Navy? Oh, man, he said, I read since I'm a little kid, man. He said, I want to got in the Navy, get on one of them big battleships there, you know. Well, son, he said, man, the Army, he said, you don't ever got to got out on the water. And he said, man, he said, you travel around here, down yonder. He said, how come you don't go ahead, man, just enlist in the Army there? Oh, no, my friend, he says, them Navy ship, what, I won't get on me. He said, man, you got your bed right there every night, man. He said, you eat and sleep in the same place all the time, you know. Well, he said, yeah, that's pretty good picture the way you paint that. But, man, he says, suppose you way out there in the middle of the ocean there, and the enemy gonna sink that ship, man, then what? Oh, man, he said, let him sink. He don't belong to me. The other day I was talking with Clofar, you know, and he was telling me this story. He said, you know, he said, I was sent through the mail there and I was getting me a new hunt dog there. He said, I name him Zeb. Man, he said, you talk about smart hunt dog. So he said, go to Begno's house then. I said, Begno, I said, look, I said, got you 2-5-16 garage gone. And we're going to pass in the woods there to make a hunt, you know. He said, I send in the mail and get that hunt dog. Man, he's smart, man, name him Zeb, you know. Man, he said, cost high, but he's full bleed, you know. So but he said, now, Begno, he said, when we gonna got on the woods there, he said, I want you to watch that, how Zeb work. Man, he said, just the way Zeb bark, man, he said, I can tell exactly what he got, you know. So he said, Clofice, may sound too good to be true. Well, he said, come on, Begno, got you gone, let's go. So, man, he said, by and by, they finally get out there to them big woods, you know. So he turned Zeb loose. Man, Zeb just wag his tail, man, he take off, you know. And after a while, man, he said, they are woo, 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 woo. Begno said, man, Clofa, he said, what Zeb got over there? Well, he said, Begno, he said, Zeb, he got a squirrel up a tree there. Man, he said, they get over there, and sure enough, got a big squirrel in the tree, man, pachoom, and knock him down, you know. Man, Zeb wag his tail big, man, he take off again, you know. After a while, they hear, woo, 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 woo. Begno said, Clofa, man, he said, what Zeb got this time? Oh, man, Begno, he said, Zeb got a rabbit in a hollow log over there. Man, he said, sure enough, they get there and look, man, big rabbit in the log, man, pachoom, man, they get the rabbit, you know. Man, he says, Zeb wag his tail big with plenty of joy that time, man, take off again, you know. Man, he get way over there and after a while, he... Begno say, Clofar, man, he say, what Zeb got now? He said, God bless. Begno, he say, Zeb ain't got nothing. There's something got Zeb, man, let's go see. So that's the way it is with me, my friend. Something got me. I got some cramp on my stomach there. I believe I got to go into the hospital to get my appendicitis take off. So if I don't see you tomorrow, hello.
Yeah.